So thank you very much for this invitation and for the introduction. After that, I'm very impressed to give this lecture in front of this broad audience. So there will be a point which will be very different from the previous lecture, is that I will talk about a very simple problem, but in the end, I will be able to say almost nothing, while Cédric was able to solve almost all problems he mentioned. So, but okay, this. So let me introduce this simple system. So this is, say, the simplest possible system of particles that you may think about if you would like to model a gas at the atomistic level. So it just consists of, say, capital N hard balls, solid balls. So they just move into straight lines. The derivative of position is just the velocity. And this velocity is constant until you have two particles which collide. Okay, so these particles they are completely identical with radius, say, epsilon, and then when the distance between two particles, between two center of particles is exactly epsilon, then you need to say what is the boundary condition for the system. Okay, and here we will assume that essentially the collision is elastic, meaning that you have to preserve both the kinetic momentum of the particles and the kinetic energy, and this tells you that you have no choice for the velocity after the collision if you would like the particles not to overlap. Okay, so with this non-penetration condition, what you get is that the velocity after the collision is given by this elastic law, okay, which is written in the bottom left. Okay, so this system is very simple, and what you can prove is that, of course, it preserves the global, the total kinetic momentum and the total energy, and actually it is defined, it's well defined globally in time for almost all initial configuration, whatever the number of particles. Okay, so here I just assume that the particles evolve, say, in a very simple geometry, which is the torus, so I have no boundary condition, and there is no geometry, no, so this is just flat geometry. Okay, then you have this property that the flow is well defined for almost all initial conditions. Okay, but of course there are some initial conditions for which the flow is not defined. You can think of the problem of having a multiple collision, so if at the same time you have three particles which collide together, then you have no idea of how to extend the flow for further time. Okay, so because of this, you see that you expect the flow to be very discontinuous in the vicinity of these very pathological situations. Okay, and furthermore, you see that if the size of the particles is very small, then you see that the flow is very unstable, meaning that if you just push a little bit one particle, so just change the position of a particle of a distance which is of the order of the radius of the particle, then you see that you can obtain two very different trajectories. Okay, so you expect this system to be very unstable, and so it's probably very difficult to say something about the deterministic dynamics of this system. Okay, so the idea right now is to say, okay, since we expect to have this mixing properties, then it would be probably more reasonable to describe the system from a statistical point of view. Okay, so use this mixing properties, the fact that you have no stability, that everything is mixed up, to say something at the statistical level. Okay, so the only thing actually that you can predict is the fact that the system will be very disordered. Okay, so this is what is usually called chaos, even though it can covered many different definitions. Okay, so maybe in a dynamical system, the most common definition of chaos is something which is related to ergodicity. Okay, so something which tells you that, say, you have an average of respect to time. Okay, so if you start from any initial condition or almost any initial condition, and then average respected to time, you expect the trajectory to describe all the phase space, or at least all, say, the invariant part of the phase space, so just restricting the phase space to some energy level, plus possibly the condition, which are due to the fact that you conserve also the kinetic momentum. Okay, so this is something which tells you mixing property with respect to time. Okay? But then there is another interesting mixing property, which is the property which is related to the number, the large number of particles. If you consider, for instance, a gas, of course you expect this capital N to be very large, typically of the order of the Avogadro number. And then what you expect, that because you have so many particles, then probably if you take two particles, any two particles fixed, tagged, then you expect these particles to be essentially uncorrelated. Okay, so this decorrelation is another, say, another expression of disorder, and this is this one which is probably most important in statistical physics, and this is, say, essentially this one that I would like to study right now. Okay, so this the first thing that we have to look at is probably the case of a system which is at equilibrium, which should be simpler than the usual, say, that the general case where you have some evolution for the system. Okay, so I just take maybe not definition, but this property from Wikipedia. So if you look at what is the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, so what is expected for the distribution of particles at equilibrium, you can read this sentence. So in idealized gases, particles do not interact with one another, except for very brief collision in which they exchange energy and momentum. Okay? And this means that each particle state can be considered independently from the other particle state. Okay, so this sentence is a little bit unclear because you have to assume both the fact that the particles do not know each other, okay, and that the particles, of course, know each other because they have to collide. Okay, so this is a statement that if you would like to have mathematical, rigorous mathematical theory of gases, have to be a little bit precise. Okay, so but then if you assume that this independence for particles, and that the system is at thermodynamic at thermal equilibrium, then Maxwell showed by some symmetry arguments, which relies on the fact that all your particles are exchangeable, so they are completely identical. You are not really interested in describing all the labels of all the particles, but just the statistical distribution of these particles, that the average number of particles in a given single particle microstate is given by this Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, which is just a Gaussian. Okay, so this means that this law for the particles, which tells you what is the repartition in the different energy states of the particles, is really related to this assumption of independence of the particles. Okay, so we will see that essentially if you know that the particles are independent, this is more or less like just a central limit theorem. Okay, so but of course this is not completely clear why you should have this independence. Okay, so let me try to look at the different mathematical results, saying something about this system, and is it possible to prove a statement like this? Okay, so for the system of n particles, n being fixed for the moment, what we expect is that any invariant measure, okay, so any equilibrium state, should depend only on the energy, okay, up to some translation of velocities, which is due to the fact that you conserve kinetic momentum. So I will just forget about this, assume that the total kinetic momentum is zero in all the sequel. And so now you see that the only invariance is the invariance, the fact that the energy is conserved, and so you expect if the system is ergodic, you expect all trajectories to explore all the energy surface. Okay? So this is what you expect. Of course, this is not what you are able to prove at the time being. At the time being, there are only very few results about this ergodicity, even though there are some really important breakthroughs from Sinai and his collaborators. So essentially, what you are able to say is either something in very small dimension, okay, so with a small number of particles, okay, or something which is just true for almost all initial data. So let me just be a little bit more precise. So either you assume that the number of particles is less than 4 or less than the dimension, okay, and then you look at your system with your identical spheres with which have all the same mass, and then you can prove that the system is ergodic, meaning that the invariant measure is just, so on this energy surface is just as full measure, okay, and or a zero measure, but I will neglect these singular invariant measures in the sequel. Or you have another result, which is probably a more recent result by Simani, which tells you that if you are in dimension 2, okay, so just in the torus of dimension 2, in the plane, then you can take any number of particles. So actually there is a restriction on the number of particles, which is related to the size of the particles. Of course, if you have too many particles with a fixed size, you see that you have essentially like a solid, everything is rigid, and then you cannot conclude anything about ergodicity. But say if the size of the particles is small enough, then for almost all distribution of masses, you can prove that the system is ergodic. Okay, but it doesn't tell you anything about the case, the particular case when all the masses are equal. Okay, so this is still an open problem to know if this system of exchangeable particles is ergodic or not. Okay, but anyway, what is sure is this measure, which are uniform on the energy level, are invariant. Okay, maybe there are others, but this one are for sure invariant. So we'll focus on this invariant measure and try to say something about the structure which is inherited by any projection of this invariant measure on, say, the one particle phase space. Okay? Of course, you are not interested in describing the state of this gas by giving the joint law of all the particles, but you are interested in more macroscopic quantities, which tells you what is the distribution of one typical particle. Okay? So here you see that if you assume that your velocities are just independent normal variables, then the central limit theorem tells you that the velocities will converge to independent normal variables. Okay? If you start from something which is uniformly a measure which is uniform on the energy level, then you expect this projection to be independent normal variables. Okay? But then you see that there is another part in your invariant measure. Of course, the invariant measure is supported in the phase space, and this phase space, you see, because of the exclusion, the fact that the particles cannot overlap, you see that this phase space is just a very small portion of say T dn cross R dn. Okay, you have that xi minus xj has to be greater than epsilon for any I and j which are different. Okay, but now if you just focus on low density regime, that is for regimes such that the number of particles times their volume, epsilon to the d, is very small, then you can prove that the partition function of the system, okay, if you look at the ratio between the partition function for the system with n minus s particles and n particles with s fixed, you can prove that this will converge to zero, which means that in the limit, asymptotically, when n tends to infinity, epsilon tends to zero, and n times epsilon to the d tends to zero, you expect this overlapping, non-overlapping condition just to disappear. Okay, so if you put together these two ingredients, then you expect, say, the projection of the invariant measure to be just the tensor product of the Maxwellian. Okay, so in this limit, in this low density regime, if you start from this invariant measure, which is just uniform on the energy level, then you see that if you look at the projection and just try to get the law for S typical particles, then you get something which is like independent normal variables with no dependence with respect to the spatial variable. Okay? And this is exactly what is used in the usual statistical physics at equilibrium. Okay? So now you can say that so this central limit theorem, you can express it in terms of this functional that Cedric has already mentioned, which is the entropy. Okay, we can define the entropy, which is just minus the integral of f log f if f is the density of the variable x. And then you have this Shannon-Stam inequality, which has already been mentioned also by Cedric, which tells you that more or less you can measure, estimate the entropy increase in the process of adding up independent variables. Okay, so actually you get that this entropy difference is equal to zero exactly when xi are independent variables with Gaussian law. Okay, and then you see that as soon as this quantity is non-negative, you can say something about the relative entropy on between this sum, okay, and the Gaussian. Okay, so this is a way to quantify the convergence to the Gaussian. Okay, so this is a little more precise. So if you start from independent variable, you can prove that actually this convergence to the normal law is quantified by and is actually satisfied in some entropic sense. Okay, but the fact that you are able to quantify a little bit this convergence is actually important if you would like to control to look at the convergence in the case of dependent variables. Because now you see that not only the fact that you will converge to the Gaussian, but you have something to measure the distance to the Gaussian. And this is also in some situations, so this is proof, for instance, for spin systems, this kind of quantity, the fact that you have, say, an estimate for this entropy increase, will be able to balance the fact that you have some entropy loss, which is due to the correlations. Okay, so this tells you that in the limit when n is very large, you can expect even for variables which are dependent from each other to get this convergence towards what is expected to be the Tambon equilibrium given by the Gibbs measure, where all the variables in the end are independent from each other. Okay, so this tells you that there are some mathematical setting to make in order that this say kind of rough property of asymptotic independence makes sense. Okay, so this is a way to quantify this convergence, and actually the fact that you can say something even for variables which are dependent is really important, and actually I think that's more close to the spirit of the work of Boltzmann, because it doesn't tell you that you have first to be at equilibrium and then to look at the projection, but that chaos, so the fact that you have this decorrelation between the particles, should be true even though you are not at equilibrium. Okay, so this should be just a property of large N, of averaging over all particles for large N, and not only a particle, a property of being at equilibrium. Okay, so right now what I would like to do is to try to understand what is this chaos and how we can understand this chaos if you are not at thermal equilibrium. Okay? And this is really important because here you have no more time averaging. The only average that you would like to perform is this average respect to the big number of particles. Okay? So essentially the main assumption in Boltzmann's theory that we like to discuss right now is the fact that the law of two particles, two fixed particles, should be equal to the product of the law for one particle, which is just the fact that the two particles are essentially independent. Okay? So of course this cannot be true for fixed n, first of all because you have this non-overlapping condition for your spheres, and secondly because you know that the product structure will not be preserved by the dynamics, but what you expect is that in some asymptotics for large n, this should be true. Okay. Okay. So the first thing that we will try to do is not to focus on this system of R-sphere, which is very complicated. Okay, but just try to understand how is the propagation of chaos for a much simpler system, which is just kind of stochastic model for just the collision process. Okay, so we will just forget about, say, the spatial dependence of, so the fact that your particles have some position, forget about the transport, and now the collision will be some stochastic jump process, which is not related to boundary condition, but just with some randomness inside the dynamics. Okay, so this is what is known as CAC's model. So here, you just try to mimic the collision process, and you say that you will have collision between the particles at some times, which are distributed according to some Poisson law. Then you, at this when this clock rings, you choose a pair of particles, and so this pair is also chosen randomly, and then you will have the same reflection laws as for the true particles. But you see that the difference is that now, of course, the time is random, and the deflection parameter, so the n in the formula at the very beginning, is also something which is random. Okay, while n in the dynamics of true particles is really depends on the relative position of the particles. Okay, so here this is a much simpler model, but still you see that it has the important property that it's micro-reversible, so the probability of doing a collision or the reverse collision is the same. Okay, and but say the main simplification is now you have a process which is like a Markov chain, meaning that the jump, each jump is completely independent from the previous history of the system. Okay. But still, that there is an interesting question, which is to know if these particles will be asymptotically independent in the limit for large n. Okay, so for large n, what you expect is that the particles, so according to the definition of Wikipedia, the particles will exchange energy and momentum, say, of the order of a macroscopic quantity of energy during time one. Okay, provided that the mean free time is one, meaning that each particle will, in average, undergo one collision per unit of time. Okay, so this means that the transition probability for each pair has to be of the order of 1 over n. Okay, because each particle may interact with all possible other particles. Okay, and so what you are interested in here is to describe what is called, say, the mean field limit, that is the dynamics, say, the approximate dynamics for the empirical measure of your spheres, which is just 1 over 1 times the sum of the Dirac masses at the velocity of each particle, in the limit when n tends to infinity. Okay, so you like to say something about, not about deterministic trajectories, you have no idea of what could be, but say about the average of these trajectories. Okay? And so now you see that you are in a limit with a very large number of variables which are not completely independent, but say at least the jump are independent. And so you expect the Boltzmann evolution to be, say, just a consequence of the law of large number. Okay, so this problem has been studied for a long time, but I think that, say, the most recent and most precise result is due to Michelet and Muho. So if you start from these n particles, which are initially independent and identically distributed, so you give the law F naught, distribution F naught, then you expect that in the mean field limit, so when n tends to infinity, the distribution of S typical particles will converge to something which is a tensor product, meaning that all these variables are independent, exactly as it was the case at equilibrium. But now it's not an equilibrium. This means that this F will evolve with time, okay? And this equation for F is what is called the Boltzmann equation. Maybe I can, if I have some time, I can write what is this Boltzmann equation. So you have something like the derivative respect to time of f is equal to the integral, so this at v, of f of v prime 1 minus f of v1, okay, times the collision cross-section, which depend only on the relative velocity and of the deflection angle. And I just recall that v prime and v prime 1 are the velocity before the collision. Okay, so this equation essentially tells you that the probability of increasing the number of particles of velocity v is something which is proportional to the product of the probability of having, say, essentially it's proportional to the probability of having both a particle of velocity v prime and a particle of velocity v prime 1. But this is equal to the product just because of this particular, not narrow in assumption, but this important result that the distribution is chaotic. Okay, and of course the probability of losing some particles of velocity v, so decreasing this density here, is just proportional to the probability of having both a particle of velocity v and a particle of velocity v1, okay, which may collide and just jump to another couple of velocities. Okay, and this just tells you what is the statistical repartition of this different collisions, okay? And of course, it's related to the microscopic process that you have defined, okay? And this is true for any fixed time, okay? So you see that in average, the dynamics, so in average, the distribution of particles will be the solution of this equation for any fixed time, okay? And what you expect is that the solution of this equation for long times will converge to the equilibrium. Actually, what you can prove is that the entropy that we have defined previously is a Lyapunov functional for this equation. So you expect really to have a relaxation towards equilibrium, and this equilibrium is just the Gaussian state that you get from the study at equilibrium. Okay, so everything here is consistent, and you can even prove that this relaxation towards equilibrium is actually uniform with respect to the parameter m. Okay, so this tells you that really this property, this chaotic property, to be more or less independent as long as you have only a finite number of particles is something which is true independently of averaging respect to time. It's true for all times, or almost all times, provided that you have this large number of particles. So here you can, if you look at the proof of this theorem, you can see that the rate of convergence is obtained, of course, as a sum of the initial errors. At time zero, you are not exactly factorized because of this problem of overlapping. And then you can estimate also the errors in the generator. So this is like really a kind of weak, strong uniqueness principle. So here you will just use the stability of the limiting equation with respect to the initial data, and then just compare the generator of the two dynamics. Okay, and you can prove that actually this convergence also holds in entropic sense. Okay, so this means that the propagation of chaos is satisfied in a very strong sense. Okay? Of course, it's not true uniformly with respect to S, so the number of the marginal, but still it's something which is very strong. Okay, so this is also something which is related to, say, information theory, which has been mentioned by Cedric. So what you know is that actually, so you have this Lyapunov functional for this equation, and so either you can prove directly just looking at the equation, but you can actually, what you prove here is that it's something which is more or less true even for fixed n. So you see that this system, this CAC system, is not exactly like the very first system that I would like to discuss, which is a system of hard spheres just colliding due to their motion, because you see that, say, the fact that you have this dissipation and that you have this Lyapunov functional is already encoded in the fact that you add this randomness in the dynamics. Okay, here in the CAX model, randomness is really something that you force each time you do a collision. Okay, so you see that here you have some dissipation, and so you understand really well what is this mechanism which leads to chaos, which is really connected to the fact that you have this dissipation so that you lose a part of the information. Okay, so what you really have to understand is that the fact that you have in this dynamics here that you have this Lyapunov functional is really due to the fact that by averaging over the number of particles, you lose part of the information so that you are not able to go back to the initial state in general. Okay? But here you see that this is already encoded in dynamics just because you said that each time you have a collision, it's something which is just stochastic. So of course, you have not all the information on the system. And this is, of course, completely different in the case of hard spheres. So now you would like to be able to have, say, a result like this one, but in the case where the dynamics is just the deterministic dynamics. Okay? So here the randomness will come only from the initial data. Okay, so you say that you assume that initially the R spheres are independent and identically distributed, so you have this initial data. So the domain Dn just encodes the fact that you have this non-overlapping condition, and then you divide by the partition function just to have a probability. Okay, so you start from this joint distribution for your n particles. Okay, so that what you can prove is that at least at time zero, you will have this chaos property. Okay, so if you look at some finite margin, also finite, the joint probability of a finite number of particles, S, you see that it will converge when n tends to infinity to the product F naught to the S. Okay, so initially you have almost independence. Okay, and now this is all the randomness that you put in your system, and now you would like the system to evolve just by itself. Okay, and say something about the chaos. So of course this will be only true in some scaling limit. So here what you would like is that, once again, particles exchange a macroscopic quantity of energy and momentum. And so you would like the particle, the mean free time, to be of the order of one. Okay, meaning that essentially each particle will undergo one collision per unit of time. So here now, if you just think of particles on the lattice, okay, so you have your n particles on the lattice, and you would like to and they are fixed, and now you have just one particle evolving in this lattice of obstacles, you can, this is a very simple computation, you can see that the mean free time, the mean free path, will be conversely proportional to n time epsilon to the d minus 1, which is the cross section, so how you see all these obstacles from the point where you are. Okay? So this is what is called the Boltzmann grad scaling, even though it has been computed by Maxwell, I think. Okay? And then you would like to derive an equation like this for the average, so for the typical distribution of one particle, just by averaging over this special scale, small special scale. Okay, so you would like to look at the limit when n tends to infinity, epsilon tends to zero, so that the collision becomes almost local in time and position. And just so with this additional condition that n times epsilon to the d minus 1 is fixed. Okay, so this is, you see, this is a completely different scaling as the mean field scaling for the CAX model, just because here you see that the probability of having a collision, so what replaced this Poisson process in time, is something which is completely deterministic and which is really due to this ratio between n and epsilon. Okay, so this is what replaced this Poisson assumption on the time of collisions. Okay, so now we have two parameters instead of just one. And then what you are able to prove, so this is once again like some law of large numbers, but we will see that it's much more complicated to prove because now we lose plenty of independence, so everything seems to be very intricate. So you start from a system of n hard spheres, exactly the one I just described at the very beginning. You assume that they are initially independent and identically distributed, meaning that the joint law for your n particle at time zero is exactly the Fn naught that I've written a couple of slides before. You assume that, okay, there are technical assumptions on the F naught, especially for large energies. Okay, in order that everything is defined, hey? And then, so in the Boltzmann grad limit, so n tends to infinity, the size of the particles tends to zero, and you have that this mean free path would be typically of the order of 1, or 1 over alpha. Then you expect the distribution of S typical particles to converge to the product. Okay, so once again, you get this chaos, okay, so in the sense that you have decorrelation between the particles. And F is a solution to the Boltzmann equation, but now it's non-homogeneous, so of course now you depend also on the space variable. So here you have this additional term here, which tells you that, say, in the absence of collision here, this is a transport, so it tells you that the position will be just increased by the velocity times the time, okay, which is just free transport. And now you have exactly the same collision operator here, and you see that T and X here are just parameters. Okay, so this is essentially the same equation, except that now you have T and X, which are parameters in the collision operator. So you have kind of balance between two phenomena, which are the transport and the collisions. This comes from kind of boundary term, and this is just dynamics. Okay? But the problem is that now, essentially, what you can prove is that this is valid only on a very short time. And this time is typically conversely proportional to alpha, which means that essentially this description by the Boltzmann equation will be valid, but just for a fraction of time, of the mean collision time. Okay, so this tells you more or less, okay, if you would like to be a little bit provocative, that this collisional model is a good approximation as long as you have no collision. Okay, which is not very interesting. And so in particular this implies that you will not see on this time scale any relaxation, you will not see equilibrium, you will not see all this kind of interesting things, nor of course a fluid limits for this kind of equation. Okay, so this is not very satisfactory from the maybe physical point of view, even from the mathematical point of view, because you have only this very short time. And this is actually not like a surprise, because actually if you would like to construct solution for this equation and not use, say, complicated technical things, this is exactly the time of existence for the solution. Okay, so this is not surprising, but still this is very bad. Okay, so I will try to explain how it works and why we have this limitation on the time, and maybe what are the perspectives to improve a little bit the understanding of this process. Okay, so the idea is that the solution of the Boltzmann equation, exactly as in the CAC process, there are good approximation as long as you have no recollision, meaning as long as two particles which will collide are independent from each other. Okay. So then what you have to estimate is the probability of a recollision. That is that two particles which already belong to the same tree of collisions will collide once again. Okay? And so this can be done, say, relatively easily for just using a geometric argument, at least in the torus or in the flat geometry. As soon as you have more complicated geometry, it can be very difficult. But say this is a very simple geometric argument. But then you see that it will depend. So the fact that the size of free collision, the fact that the probability of having such a recollision is small, is also something which will depend very strongly on the number, total number of collisions of your particle. Okay, so as long as this number is controlled, there is no problem. And then the problem to understand the propagation of chaos is really to say that now if you have a lot of collision, what you expect, of course, if you would like to see some relaxation, then this is very bad, and you are not able to propagate chaos. Okay? So you see that this is a little bit like a contradiction, because you expect so chaos to come from the mixing, and now you see that here, having collision, so which should be good for chaos, is like an obstacle to prove chaos. Okay, so this is not satisfactory. Okay, so there is one case where we can prove something a little bit better, which is a recent result that we proved with Thierry Bodino and Isabelle Callagher. So you start from the same system, just in dimension 2, but this is exactly the same system with the same dynamics, but you start from something which is very close to an equilibrium. Okay, and now you would like to say that you are able to push a little bit this time, okay? Because at least at equilibrium, you know that everything is stationary, so nothing should be valid only for a small time. So now you expect that if you are very close to this equilibrium, then the time for which you can say something should be bigger. Okay, so this is exactly what is proved here, is that essentially if you start with this very small fluctuation of order 1 over n, then you are able to prove the convergence, something which is linearized, so this equation just linearized around the equilibrium, okay, and this is true for all time. So in particular, you will see the relaxation and this fluid limits and these kind of things. Okay, and so the result is maybe not very important, but what is important is that in this proof, there is something which tells us something a little bit more about chaos and dissipation. Because we saw in the example of CAC's model that you expect chaos to be really related to this loss of information and dissipation. Okay, so here, essentially, the idea to say that the contribution of this super exponential collision tree, so these very big collision trees where you can have some recollision, is to use some a priori estimate and some sampling procedure, and together with an estimate, so this a priori estimate comes from, say, something which is essentially the linearized entropy. So we are not able to use the entropy, but in the linear case, the linearized case, we are able to use this entropy and this global bound, which is satisfied for all times. Okay, so of course, this is not as in the limiting case where the entropy will be a Lyapunov functional, but still the entropy is something which is controlled for which you have a bound for all times. Okay, and actually, if you look at this linearized entropy, you can decompose in two different parts. So one part which is exactly the entropy of say the first marginal, so the distribution of one particle. And then you have plenty of other terms, and these other terms, they exactly measure the correlations. Okay, so now instead of the H theorem for this equation, which tells you that you have something like the entropy plus the integral from 0 to t of the entropy dissipation, which, say, formally is equal to the entropy at time 0, in the case of the system of particles, what you get is that this entropy here for the one particle distribution plus something here which is not the integral from 0 to t of something, but just a sum of the L2 norm of all correlations. Okay, so this, in the case of the system of particles, is just saying something about correlations. Okay, so this is exactly what you have in mind, that this entropy production or entropy dissipation, depends on the convention that you use, but should tell you something about these correlations. Okay, so it's, of course, the dynamics itself is reversible, so that there is nothing like a Lyapunov functional in your system, but here you see that you can decompose more or less in one main part, which is the projection on this one particle distribution, plus something else, which is more or less the projection on the orthogonal thing, okay, provided that you can define the orthogonal of this one-dimensional space, okay, and you see that, so this is the second identity which is written here, you see that this really tells you that in this linear regime, this correlation is very small, okay, so you have essentially a one-particle distribution which will evolve on time one, plus correlation, which are very small. Okay? So you see that here, what you are able to use to get this very long time convergence is something which is related to this correlation and this dissipation. Okay? So now what you would like to be is to be able to do is do the same, say, the non-linear setting to get this equation here. And maybe I have to say that from this equation, you can derive, say, most of the fluid models such as the Euler and Navier-Stokes equation. So this means that you have to understand this dissipation at the non-linear level. Okay? So essentially, you have an identity which is very close to the one I have mentioned in the case of linear things, but we are not able to use this. And actually, the problem is that we don't really understand this different mixing mechanism, but probably there is something like this. So this could be a picture of the different mechanism that you have to understand and then to put together in order to get this propagation of chaos for longer times, which is not only chaos coming from the initial data that you force for all times, but also something which comes really from the mixing properties of the system, and this is exactly what you would like to be able to describe. Okay, so the idea would be something like this. So first step, you have the transport, and so on the very small scale, what you expect is that the transport has some mixing property. This is something which is well known, so which is, for instance, the fundamental property to prove the Landau damping, effect, or some other Stricard's effects, or things like this. So we know that the transport has this dispersion property and this mixing property. And so what we expect, so at least what physicists expect, is that the distribution of hard spheres, if you look at an intermediate scale, which is not exactly the scale of the size of the particles, but epsilon to the 2/3, okay, in dimension 2, in the dimension 3, and d minus 1 over d in dimension d. So you expect that this create a kind of mixing, and so the distribution of your particles at this scale should be essentially Poisson. Okay. Now, if you have this spatial randomness, you see that now the mechanism, the collision mechanism, should be very similar to Kac's process. Okay, because Kac's process is exactly, say, the reduction of this dynamics in the case when you know that the deflection parameter, so what plays the role of this small scale, is given by a law that you already know. Okay, so you expect that now this Kac process, you know that it mixes the velocity. Okay, so the idea is that at the very small scale, you have transport mixing the position, and this mixing on the position will become something like a mixing on velocities, just as in Kac's process. Okay, and then you can use transport and hypo-coercive properties of this equation, which tells you that if you have a good collision mechanism here, you will have kind of relaxation towards local equilibrium, but transport will tell you something about the relaxation towards global equilibrium. Okay, so this is what is known as hypo-coercivity, but you see that here you have really all these different scales which are mixed in some sense, and so if you would like to understand, say, why you have this chaotic properties, probably you have to understand how these different levels will speak to each other, and this is probably what is behind is probably something like renormalization. Okay, I think I have to stop here, and I thank you very much for your attention.
Well, thank you very much for this nice overview on the progress, or the lack of progress also, on this most fundamental physical problem that we encounter every day here in the room, the air. So are there questions? I cannot really see much. Yes. Can you have a microphone to Cedric?
Thank you. In the result to obtain in the linearized regime on very long times, do you use spectral estimates on the linearized Boltzmann equation, and which ones? And if yes, for which kind of interactions would you? So no spectral estimates.
So here everything is for hard spheres.
Everything for hard spheres, but
yeah.
Is it implicit the fact that there is a spectral gap and so on? Does it help?
I would say not really, but let me. No, I think actually what you use is that you is like in the proof by Moore and Michler. So you use the fact that you know a lot of information on the limiting equation, and then that you can compare, say, for small times. The limiting equation and your system of particles. And the fact that you are able to push a little bit the time and not only to do this on a very small times is due to this additional estimate that you obtain for the system of particles coming from this kind of entropy inequality.
And so is there a relation with the so-called Yao method in particle systems? The Yao method with modulated entropy with respect to the limit equation, not really either.
No, because here actually you don't expect the modulated entropy to converge. So you don't expect convergence of the modulated entropy.
But here in this case, modulated L2, which would be linearized version, not either.
I'm not sure that it's such strong convergence is true.
Okay.
Are there any other questions? I don't see any more questions. So, well, then we thank Laure again for talk.